Simon & Schuster Audio presents Wolves Eat Dogs by Martin Cruz Smith. Read by Ron McLarty.
Moscow swam in color. Hazy floodlights of Red Square mixed with the neon of casinos in Revolution Square. Light wormed its way from the underground mall in the Manej. Spotlights crowned new towers of glass and polished stone, each tower capped by a spire. All night earth movers tore at the old city and dug widening pools of light to raise a modern vertical Moscow, more like Houston or Dubai. It was a Moscow that Pasha Ivanov had helped to create. Senior investigator Arkady Renko leaned out a window, the better to see Ivanov on the pavement 10 floors below. Ivanov was dead, but not particularly bloody, arms and legs at odd angles. Ivanov had arrived at 9:28 p.m., gone directly up to the safest apartment in Moscow, and at 9:48 p.m., plunged to the sidewalk. Arkady had measured Ivanov's distance from the building. Homicides generally hit close, having expended their energy in trying not to fall. Suicides were single-minded and landed farther out. Ivanov had almost reached the street. Behind Arkady in the living room, Prosecutor Surin had brought drinks from the wet bar to a Novi-Rus senior vice president named Timofeev, and a young blonde. Surin was as fussy as a maitre d'. He had survived 6 Kremlin regimes by recognizing his best customers and smoothing out their problems. Timofeev had the shakes, and the girl was drunk. Arkady thought the gathering was a little like a party, where the host had suddenly and inexplicably dived through the window. After the shock, the guests carried on. The odd man out was Bobby Hoffman, Ivanov's American assistant. Although he was worth millions of dollars, his loafers were split, his fingers were smudged with ink, and his suede jacket was worn to a shine. Arkady wondered how much more time Hoffman had at Novi-Rus. An assistant to a dead man? That didn't sound promising. Hoffman joined Arkady at the window. "Why are there plastic bags around Pasha's hands?" "I was looking for signs of resistance, maybe cuts on the fingers." "Resistance? Like a fight?" Prosecutor Surin rocked forward on the sofa.
"There is no investigation. We do not investigate suicides. There are no signs of violence in the apartment. Ivanov came up alone. He left alone. That, my friends, is a suicide in spades."
The girl lifted a dazed expression. Arkady had learned from the file he had on Pasha Ivanov that Rina Shevchenko was his personal interior designer, a 20-year-old in a red leather pantsuit and high-heeled boots. Timofeev was known as a robust sportsman, but he could have been Ivanov's father. He had shrunk so much within his suit.
"Suicides are a personal tragedy. It's enough to suffer the death of a friend. Colonel Ozhogin, the head of Novi-Rus security, is already flying back. He wants nothing done until he arrives."
Arkady said,
"We don't leave a body on the sidewalk like a rug, even for the colonel." "Pay no attention to Investigator Renko," Surin said. "He's the office fanatic. He's like a narcotics dog. He sniffs every bag."
There won't be much left to sniff here, Arkady thought. Timofeev pressed a handkerchief against his nose. Arkady saw spots of red.
"Nosebleed?" asked Surin.
"Summer cold," said Timofeev. Opposite Ivanov's apartment was a dark office building. A man walked out of the lobby, waved to Arkady, and gave a thumbs down.
"One of your men?"
Hoffman asked. "A detective, in case someone over there was working late and might have witnessed something."
"But you're not investigating."
"I do whatever the prosecutor says."
"So you think it was suicide?"
"We prefer suicides,"
Suicides don't demand work or drive up the crime rate.
Surin said, You will excuse Renko. He thinks all of Moscow is a crime scene. The problem is that the press will sensationalize the death of someone as eminent as Pasha Ivanov.
In which case, better the suicide of an unbalanced financier than assassination, Arkady thought. Timofeev might lament the suicide of his friend, but a murder investigation could place the entire Novirus company under a cloud, especially from the perspective of foreign partners and investors who already felt that doing business in Russia was a dip in murky water. Since Surin had ordered Arkady's financial investigation of Ivanov, this U-turn had to be executed with dispatch. But Surin was a skillful sailor who knew when to tack.
Who had access to this apartment? Arkady asked.
Pasha was the only one allowed on this level, Surin said. The entire building is covered by surveillance cameras inside and out, with monitors that are watched not only at the reception desk here, but as a safeguard also by technicians at the headquarters of Novirus Security. The other apartments have keys. Ivanov had a keypad with a code known only to him. He also had a lockout button by the elevator to keep out the world when he was in. He had all the security a man could wish for.
The building staff doesn't have Ivanov's code? Arkady asked.
No, only the central office at Novirus.
Who had access to the code there?
No one, it was sealed until tonight.
According to the prosecutor, Ivanov had ordered that no one enter the apartment but him. Anyone who tried would appear on monitors and on tape, and the staff had seen nothing.
Eccentric, Arkady said.
Pasha wasn't crazy, Rina said.
How would you describe him?
He had lost weight. He said he had an infection. Maybe he had a bad reaction to medication.
An ambulance rolled discreetly to the curb. The detective crossed the street with a camera and shot flash pictures of Ivanov being rolled into the body bag and of the stain on the pavement. Something had been concealed under Ivanov's body. From Arkady's distance, it looked like a drinking glass. The detective took a picture of that, too. Hoffman watched Arkady as much as the scene below.
Is it true? You treat Moscow like a crime scene?
Force of habit.
Timofeev said to no one in particular,
Pasha and I go far back. We studied and did research together at the Institute when the country suffered its economic collapse. Imagine, the greatest physics laboratory in Moscow, and we worked without pay. The director, academician Gerasimov, turned off the heat in the buildings to save money. And of course it was winter and the pipes froze. We had 1,000 liters of radioactive water to discharge, so we sent it into the river in the middle of Moscow, and no one knew.
Arkady was taken aback. He certainly hadn't known.
Arkady noticed a barely perceptible glitter on the windowsill, scattered grains of crystals so familiar he could not resist pressing his forefinger to pick them up and taste them. Salt.
I'm going to look around, he said.
But you are not investigating, Hoffman said.
Absolutely not.
Ivanov's apartment took up the entire 10th floor. There weren't many rooms, but they were spacious and commanded a wraparound view of the city that gave the illusion of walking on air. Arkady began at a bedroom upholstered in linen wall panels, laid with a Persian rug. A rosy nude, a Modigliani hung on the wall. On the night table were an ashtray of Lalique glass and an Hermé alarm clock. In the drawer was a 9mm pistol with a fat clip of 17 rounds, but not a whiff of ever having been fired. An attaché case on the bed held a single ballet shoe sack and a mobile phone charger cord. The only off note was dirty laundry piled in a corner. He moved into a bathroom with a limestone floor, gold-plated fixtures on a step-in spa, heated bars for robes large enough for polar bears. A medicine cabinet held, besides the usual toiletries,
Bottles of Viagra, sleeping pills, Prozac. Arkady noted a Dr. Novotny's name on each prescription. The kitchen looked both new and forgotten, with gleaming steel appliances, enameled pots without a single smudge, and burners with not one spot of crusted sauce. At the twist of a rheostat, the next room turned into a home theater with a flat screen a good 2 meters wide. There was no tape in the tape player, and nothing in the mini-fridge but splits of Moet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.